himself. The hair of his head was white like wool. His throne was flaming with fire, and his wheels were all ablaze. A river of fire was flowing, coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was seated, and the books were open.
Lord, you are Lord. have a word, give it.
For not only am I Lord, I am your Father. All those that are burdened and heavy laden, come to me and I will give you rest. Come.
Prepare your heart to receive my heart. Prepare your heart to receive the Father's heart.
Yes.
Because it's the Father's heart, not selfish.
Yes.
It's the Father's heart, not concerned about himself. But it's not the Father's heart for the children. Prepare your heart to receive the Father's heart. Amen. Wonderful man we have in fellowship. We are so blessed. So blessed. Yeah, we can do that one. I don't have much money. Just in case that gets him running out. We never know. If it was bad, just look in. Our chairs are working. Yeah. That's good. Is that too far back? No, I'll be good. All right. We never know when I'm going to take a run. Right? Well, Son Tayo, if you're there, would you introduce your guest?
Okay, I have with me Ekele Schweibu, one of our brothers, based here in America, at California. He came all the way for the conference starting
from
Tuesday. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, and I have our senior pastor, in person of Pastor Emeka, able to go all the way from Lagos, Nigeria.
From Nigeria.
Yes,
welcome, you pastor. Would you just go ahead and pass them out as a reminder? This conference starts Tuesday night, and it is always powerful, and it is the word of God on steroids, just so you know.
Amen.
The word of God on steroids. And I am blessed, so if y'all can come, you will be blessed. God has given a special blessing on the Church of Nigeria to be given such a deep revelation of the Word of God. I was thinking this morning, sometimes we with men of God, they get our women of God. They get to wanting their revelations to be the latest Schofield or the latest Dacre. They're the absolute, but if you read those commentaries or even Matthew Henry, God keeps bringing revelations on the earth, and every generation will have more revelations. There's no one that's going to have the last word of the Lord.
Amen.
Because we keep getting revelations and revelations and revelations of heaven. And we're always glad when Wayne and Dave show up. They came here for their Father's Day. And it's so good. I just They're going to come to conference, too. Okay. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Did I say Happy Father's Day?
No.
I didn't say Happy Father's Day, JJ.
I haven't heard that at all. We know Wayne needs to come more often. Imperfect.
Say imperfect.
Imperfect.
I think I thought I was perfect. But I soon, if I look back, I was thinking this week, I said, oh God, did you ever remember something stupid you did? You think of something really stupid that you said, and then I said, how could I have been so stupid? And then I said, well, you're supposed to cover everything stupid I've ever done under the blood, and it's forever forgotten, and I shouldn't even have to be remembering that, right? And then once in a while, one of those things pops up. I think God reminds me how stupid things I did, so that I will have compassion and kindness toward other people do stupid things. Not that anyone ever does.
Oh, no.
Okay. And though we were both imperfect, even on the bad days, I always respected him. Mm-hmm. If y'all knew him, you did too.
Yeah.
I told y'all the story about me. When we were living at the home at the time, he was working for Texaco, and I think with Alabama and LSU were playing in New Orleans, maybe. Anyway, one of our neighbors was a big head of some kind of company. So he came over and he said, he was for Alabama. He came over and he said, Don, I want to give you some tickets to take with me just in case I get in trouble at this game. I want you sitting by me. I would never have given a slug, but he could have intimidated them before they ever opened the mouth. Hallelujah. It's the reason why I'm not intimidated.
Yes.
I haven't met a man yet that intimidates me.
That's right.
Our woman. You know why? I was married to the master intimidated. J.T. Newman.
Amen. I knew it. I respect it too.
Yes. Okay, according to Webster, respect is a feeling of admiration for someone or something elicited by their abilities, qualities, or their achievements. That doesn't define respect for me, but I'm just showing you what Webster said. The synonyms for it are esteem, regard, high opinion, acclaim, admiration, appreciation, estimation, favor, and recognition. The antonym is contempt, disrespect, and disdain. Psalm 123:4 describes that contempt is the fruit of pride. You have to watch it in your life. Remember how God reminds me when I was stupid. Or if he let you do something stupid, just to let me know that I'm only saved by grace.
Yes.
If I have contempt for another person's failures, I'm operating in pride.
Come on, good word, Pastor. Come on.
Yeah. There are many different words in the Bible translated as respect. However, the main thought seems to be throughout the Bible, in respect, I will look toward you. In disrespect, I will turn away from you. And that makes all the sense in the world. If you look toward a person, and I'm not talking about just looking at them. If you recognize them. If you give them place. If you give them recognition, you're looking toward them. And if you ignore them, and their words don't mean anything, and you just kind of disregard them, then you are disrespecting. You're looking away from them. Is that a good, y'all think that's good?
Yeah.
When I searched the Bible, and I did last night, yesterday, there were different places where Pharaoh would turn away from Moses. He was disrespecting him.
Yeah.
Okay, and I would go through there, and that was when disrespect was shown. Okay. People, because they are people, have different notions of what they respect. Lots of people respect a big house.
Hmm.
A lot of people respect a big car.
Hmm.
Or lots of cars. Or fancy cars. But they do. I'm not. I'm not telling you. Hey, Houston's built on it.
Yeah.
When I came here, I got it. When I first came here, I observed the spirit of pride over Houston. The bigger the house you live in, the bigger was your ego. Okay? Well, I mean, not that that was your ego, but that was a recognition of your prestige.
Yes.
It was a Houston thing. Maybe universal, I don't know. Okay, today, I'm handing out a piece of paper. JT, will you help me? And as we, each one of you, are getting an assignment. just tear it off and get it in there. Okay. Write on there no more than three words of what you respect. I was going to do one word, but you know, we respect different things. Okay. So I want you to write on there three, Jenny, you get an assignment today. Three words of what you respect in your life.
Don't put your name on.
What you say,
don't put your name on.
Well, you don't have to. Right. You don't have to sign for that. Yeah. You don't have to sign your name on it, but if you want to, it's okay. It's okay. This is not a test.
You know who you are.
All right? This is not a test, Sandra. I am provoking you to check your heart.
Yes.
I am provoking you to check your heart. Be honest with yourself, because God already knows what you respect.
Yeah.
Okay? This is not a test. You will not impress him with a pseudo-spiritual answer, and you're sure not going to impress me, because I'm a prophet and I already know where you are. You might have a few things hid from me, but God just gave you time to repent.
That's right.
However, if a spiritual answer is genuine, please be honest and state it with boldness. I mean, you know, if there's something, if what you really is spiritual, please write it down. Now, JT, you're not finished.
Uh-huh.
Okay, let's see. Now, before JT picks it up, we got another assignment. Is everybody finished? Tell me if you're finished.
No.
Okay. I want the husbands and wives first to exchange your notes. Okay. And read them. Okay, well, then your time's up. Okay. Husbands and wives. Exchange your notes and read them. Okay. All right. Now, since it's Father's Day, if your father's in the house, give your note to your father. Chris. Okay. Chris is, yeah, come on. And, okay, we're going good here, right? Mm-hmm. Y'all okay?
Chris,
okay. Now, JT, would you come pick them up if they're done? Okay. The JT still right. Mm-hmm. learn something about your spouse that you didn't know. Did you? No, you already knew these things about your spouse. Okay. Did y'all get to work? Now then, later on, I'm going to open some of them up. And I won't read your name.
Okay, I'm supposed to.
Okay.
I only got two.
Those who find this path are church. The room was filled with great joy, expectation, supernatural light, and the glory cloud was there. Obvious glory cloud was in the room. It was visible. That was the end of the dream. So at the time I wrote, could it be that great joy, expectation, brilliant light, and glory cloud was the presence of our Father God anticipating that time? That today we will remember to honor our earthly fathers, but we will also remember that the Father is also our Daddy God.
Amen.
That Father God has great joy because of his children. We never outgrow our need for a Father's love. We were wired to receive it. Jairus, tell my story about Jairus, is the leader of the synagogue. That may not mean much to you or me, but in the days of Christ, the leader of the synagogue was the most important man in the community. Say respect. He had respect. Synagogue was the center of religion, education, leadership, and social activity. The leader of the synagogue was the senior religious leader, the highest ranking professor, the mayor, and the best known citizen all rolled into one. Say respect. Jairus had respect. Jairus had it all. Job security. A guaranteed welcome at the coffee shop. Walked down the street and they knew his name. A kitchen plan. Golf every Thursday and an annual all expenses paid trip to the National Convention. Who could ask for more? Yet Jairus does. He has to ask for more. In fact, he would trade the whole package of perks and privilege for just one assurance. That his daughter will live. The Jairus we see in this story is not the clear-sighted, black-frocked, nicely-groomed civic leader. He is instead a blind man begging for a gift. He fell at Jesus' feet, the Word of God says, saying again and again, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her, so that she will be healed and live." He doesn't barter with Jesus. "You do me a favor and I'll see you're taken care of for life." He doesn't negotiate with Jesus. "The guys in Jerusalem are getting pretty testy about your antics. Tell you what, you handle this problem of mine and I'll make a few calls." He doesn't make excuses. "Normally I'm not this desperate, Jesus, but I've got a small problem." He just pleads. We've all been in that place.
Yes.
Where we get before the Lord.
Yes.
We're not covering ourselves with excuses. Yeah. We're not making excuses. "We did this because, you know, Lord, it was Eve's fault." He just pleads. There are times in your life when everything you have to offer is nothing compared to what you're asking to receive. Jairus is at such a point. What could a man offer in exchange for his child's life? So there are no games, no haggling, no masquerades. The situation is starkly simple. Jairus is blind to the future, and Jesus knows the future. So Jairus asks for help. And Jesus, who loves the honest heart, goes to give it. Okay, I don't want to get ahead of myself. I will say this. Jesus had respect for Jairus' heart. I would say Jesus had respect for Jairus' heart. He didn't have any motives. He didn't have anything that was, if you do this for me, I'll do that for you. Sorry about this noise up there, not believing God, who knows what it's like to lose a child, empowers his son. We know the story. On the way to Jairus' house, and Jesus turned to go. Jesus was followed and surrounded by the crowd. The woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment and was healed. Before Jesus finished speaking with her, people arrived from Jairus' house to give Jairus the news. There's no need to trouble the master any longer. Your daughter has died. Jesus spoke the wonderful words of life to Jairus. Be not afraid. Only believe. Be not afraid. Only believe. He would not allow anyone to go with him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Jesus proclaimed to the weeping of the people, the girl is not dead, but she is sleeping. Jesus took the child's father and mother and his three disciples into the room where the girl was lying, and he threw everybody else out because they would have been saying he couldn't do it. He kept faith in the room, and he threw those who didn't have faith out. He tenderly clasped the child's hand and said to her in Aramaic, Talitha kum, which means little girl, wake up from the sleep. Instantly, the 12-year-old girl sat up, stood to her feet, and started walking around the room. Father God never dismisses a parent's prayer. Keep giving your child to God, and in the right time and in the right way, God will give your child back to you.
Amen.
Just remember, your kids were God's kids first.
That's right.
He just gave them to you to raise.
Yes.
You're just like you are stewards of this world. You're stewards of your finances. You're just stewards of those children that God made.
Amen.
And what God has promised you of those children, be not afraid. God is going to do exactly what he said he was going to do. I have lived long enough to see it. And every child that is born into the world will have to overcome the demons of their generation. I wasn't that smart. I thought that just because I saw those demons, that my children would be smart enough to see those demons too. No. To them, that is their peer group.
Yes.
They have to overcome the power of the peer group.
Jesus. It's a good word, Pastor.
Yeah. They have to overcome the demons of their generation. God had respect for Jairus' prayer. David asked the Lord to respect his prayer. 2 Chronicles 6:19. Have respect to the prayer of your servant and to his supplication, O Lord my God, to hearken unto the cry and the prayer which your servant prays before you. Jairus had the respect of Jesus Christ when he prayed his prayer. There wasn't anything in that prayer. He wasn't Dr. Kathy asked. Head of the synagogue. He wasn't Apostle so-and-so who had been sent to save the whole world. He wasn't the one who knew all the Holy Bible and could tell you everything that was written in there. He wasn't the rich man that lived in the big house down the road. When he went to Jesus, he had a heart that said, I have no power to heal my daughter. I have nothing to offer you, but I know that you have the power to heal her. And Jesus had respect for Jairus' prayer. Men of God, women of God, let us keep our hearts before the Lord. call to not only save your families, but to be instruments of wherever you are to bring the people into Christ.
Amen. Amen.
You are crying out to God, some of you to save your family, some of you for financial needs for your family, some of you for healing for your family, some of you for deliverance from your family. As Jenny said earlier, when we first raised our first child, they had to be perfect so that we look perfect. Didn't have that ego problem? I did. Like I told you earlier, after all, I was perfect. Until I had a child, and I began to see how really imperfect I was. I'm the only one in here who put pressure on their first job. I can tell. But I'm so much smarter with my grandchildren.
Yes. Amen. Yeah. Amen.
They don't have to be perfect anything. I just love them.
That's right.
I just love them. That's the way Jesus does to us. So I began to study the scriptures yesterday to discover what the Lord respects. The first mention of God's respect was to Abel. Genesis 4:4-5. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. See, he not only brought an offering, he brought the fat of his offering.
Best one yet.
And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had no respect. With the condition of Abel's heart. Cain gave grudgingly. Abel not only gave his offering, but he gave the fat with it. The Lord told the Israelites that he would respect them. Number two. And bless them contingent upon them not worshiping idols and complete obedience to God. Leviticus 26:9. For I will have respect unto you and make you fruitful and multiply you and establish my covenant with you. When Israel was under attack by Syria during the time of King Jehoahaz, the Lord had respect unto them because of his word, because of the word that he gave them. He respected his word. I said, when God speaks his word to you, when God speaks his word to you, God will respect his word to you. If you receive a prophetic word and you get a witness that it's from the Lord and not out of the soul of the prophet, some prophets today prophesy their soul, and they'll prophesy to your soul. Because they can read what your soul wants. I said to you, prophets can read what your soul wants. They are not to prophesy to your soul. They are to prophesy to your spirit. From the Spirit of God. Yes. Yes. So when God says that he respects his word, that he respected his word. That's a covenant. That's sealed. What is written in the Word of God and what God has declared over your life, he will respect. And that which you walk, and that which you speak, and that which you declare, and that which you decree, that is written in the Word of God, he will respect. And if you come into agreement with the world system, and you come into agreement with what, and you declare a negative, and you declare criticism, and you declare condemnation, God will not have respect for your prayer or what you say. God will not have respect for your complaining.
Amen.
He's not going to respect your complaining. Get over it. Just start saying what God said.
Yes. Yes.
All right. I didn't tell you what the word was. 2 Kings 13:23. And the Lord was gracious unto them, and had compassion on them, and had respect unto them, because of his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and would not destroy them, neither did he cast them from his presence as yet. Psalm 138:6. Though the Lord be high, yet he has respect unto the lowly, but the proud he knows afar off. You see, Jairus came to him with a lowly heart.
Yes.
He did not come to him as the man that was head of the synagogue.
Yes.
He didn't come to him and say, I'm sitting as mayor of this city. Jesus, I need you to do a little special something here for me. He came to him as a lowly man whose feet was made of clay.
Yes.
If he had come to him proud and said, because I am somebody, I need to get you to over the side here, and I need some special favors from you, Jesus. That's the way our corporate world works today.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, a lot goes on in churches work today.
Yes.
Much of it's about relationship.
Yeah.
But see, according to my word, God has no respect for the proud.
Amen.
But he has respect for the lowly.
Amen.
And that doesn't mean, see, Jairus was a man of success. He was a successful man.
Yes.
And this doesn't mean that you're not successful in life. It means that you are lowly when you come to God.
Yeah.
And then he will respect our prayer.
Good Lord, that's good stuff.
With God, there is no respect to persons. Whether you're rich, beautiful, live in the biggest house, whether you're on food stamps.
That's right.
Whether you're poor. There is no respect to persons. You can be poor and have as much pride as a man goes up there in a big house.
That's right.
When I worked in the bank, I heard you tell this story, but it's good. And they would come in on Friday payday. All that man had. But where this particular branch was, I worked in different ones. But this particular branch was in an area in Baton Rouge where all the people from all the plants come in on Friday afternoon. They came in the droves and cashed their weekly check. But I watched those men walk out the door. That's all they had, that one paycheck. Rich men walked out that door. They walked out rich, but they had worked hard and they had their paycheck. Same thing working at the bank. I've seen men come in there with hundreds of thousands of dollars on deposit, but they were complaining and murmuring and unhappy and trying to check every penny of money that they had. Lord has given us a command to honor our father and mother with a blessing. God gives you. This does not mean the godly fathers and mothers. This does not mean the good fathers and mothers. This means every father and mother.
All right.
Biological. And I want to honor JT here. He grew up without his father most of his life. All your life without his father. But he found his father in his last days. Yeah. And he didn't have long to live. He was dying. JT went to see, even though he didn't. His father was never a father to him. JMST went to visit him, took care of him the best he could. And JT honored his father with a funeral. And I preached at it. Mm-hmm. But his father wasn't in his life when he was growing up. But JT, because you did, that was in your heart, that you honored your father, you will have a long life. Mm-hmm. And it will be well with you in life. All the days of your life.
Amen.
Amen.
Man of God, I bless you today. As men who have respect of God. And that he will respect your prayers. Bless your families. With the blessing of your Heavenly Father. May you know and experience the blessing of the love and respect of Father God in your life. I have great honor for you. Great affection for your goodness. Standing with a woman pastor, my goodness. Not many men would do such. Thank you. Billy and I posted this week, which I sent it to my daughter and Don's nephews. I probably copied you on it. Chad Sanders said I got it. I heard back from a nephew and Linda. Right away, I heard back from one of the nephews, and my two girls were silent. But I got a real sweet text. So, okay, no crying.
Bill Yacht.
Yeah, this week, I hope. He says, when I was a child, my father drank heavily at times of years. And I felt like I could never please him. Okay, what says the perfectionist parents who are you have standards so high that she had to tell me one time when she was probably 11 or 12 years old. Mother's standards so high no one could ever reach it. My father Patty, Billy up talking. My father passed away many years ago. One of the last times I saw him in the hospital, I left his bedside and was walking toward the door when I heard my father say, "Bless you, Bill." It was though everything within me was waiting my whole life to hear those words from my father. I literally felt something in the spirit break off of me from my head to my toes, and I have never been the same since. I know a mother's loves and prayers for her children are powerful, but nothing on earth can ever take the place of a father saying to his children, "I love you and I bless you." I want to interject here. When a father says that, he releases in the spirit realm a blessing over his children. Just as Bill felt it in spirit, because he's very sensitive to Bill Hawkins. I sense many of you have been raised with an earthly father who loved you, but somehow failed to communicate his love and affirmation to you. You have grown up, but there's still an unanswered cry coming up out of you. Daddy, where are you? Being an earthly father of three children and a man of God through the blood of Christ, I would like to pray right now over you to release an earthly father's blessing upon your life by faith. I'm going to stand in proxy in the place of your earthly father and lay my hand upon your head and speak an earthly father's blessing. Listen carefully, for many of you have never heard these words before. I love you, I love you. You are so special. You were born to shape the world, and there is nothing you cannot do. I am so proud of you. You are my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. You are my beloved daughter. You are Daddy's favorite little girl in the entire world. I love you. I bless you coming in and going out. I bless you in the marketplace, in the city, and in the field. I bless your wallets and purses that they will never know what lack is. He heard me pray, J.T. I bless the fruit of your loins and your children's children. In Jesus' name, I break that generational curse of an orphan spirit off of you and your family.
Amen.
That orphan spirit that tells you you don't belong. I bless those yet to be born, that they will be born crying, "My daddy loves me." I cancel every negative curse ever spoken against you in Jesus' name. I bless you with an earthly father's blessing that cancels those curses. And as the Father has sent me, so I send you into your purpose and destiny. And nothing will stop you now. You will go the distance to finish what God has called you to do. I bless you and I love you. I love you. I love you. I bless you with an earthly father's blessing. Father, open the heavens over these loved ones and show them how much you love them. Tell someone, "My daddy loves me." Say it out loud, church.
My daddy loves me.
Come on, Bill. Yeah. That's a good word.
I respect the Lord of the gospel. I respect the men who have blessed in the word of God over my life. I respect my family. Just read all of them. It's good. I have y'all blessing me. I respect the Lord Jesus, spiritual authority, and family life. Look at how many people respect family life in you. I respect the Word of God, spiritual authority, and the apostles. I respect Dad, Mom, Joel, Jenny. I respect thankfulness, truth, and tolerance. That's not having contempt or tolerance. I respect integrity and tenderness. Someone who considers others. Someone who's not selfish. Being selfless, authority. How you treat others. This is good. We might do this again another time. God, wife, law and order. God, wife, and kids. That's what God's order.
Yes.
We're to keep our life in order. God, family, and then our job.
Yes.
Okay. Ministers of the gospel, money, elderly parents. Why am I not elderly parents? Integrity and humility.
That's good.
Got a clown here. So the question mark there. Okay, that means you got to check your heart, see what you got in there. It's okay, I'm not gonna say anything. It's a Holy Trinity, fivefold ministry, and those who walk in them. Spiritual heritage. Those who provide them. Okay, that's good. Yeah. I have a lot of respect for the anointing. My God, my wife, and children, my country. Those are good answers, y'all. People who I think are godly. Kindness, courage, and diligence. Y'all get a hand clap. Yeah. That's good.
Did you read it all?
I did. Is yours not in here? Oh, one more down here. We now know who it is. Yeah. God, my husband, my president, and my pastor. Oh, Jimmy, thank you. Thank you. God bless you all. Now, was that fun or what?
Yes, it was.
Okay, we're going to hand out the roses. And I'll pray for you when you come up. Men first, fathers first. Cindy, we got any men?